There we go. And I would like to introduce you to Robin Lloyd. And Robin Lloyd is going to talk to you today about no lab coat required. So I'm going to hand over to you and you can let everybody know a little bit more about yourself. Thank you, Robin.
Well, I'm going to turn my video off because for a couple of reasons. But good afternoon to everybody. Appreciate you joining me at this time. I'm not sure whether this is before lunch, after lunch. So I don't know whether you're in that post-lunchtime slumber or you're ravenously hungry. But I've got I've got a few slides here that I'm going to share, and I'm going to talk about where chemistry has played a role in my career, why I studied it, and just give some ideas for where chemistry can be an applicable topic and a subject and discipline outside of the world of research and a laboratory. I unashamedly went into the commercial world 25 odd years ago, and it's still a highly relevant subject, and so I'd just like to talk you through that. My talk here should probably take about 20 minutes, but I'm happy to take any questions at the end if I inspire anybody enough to ask me a few questions on that. The no lab coat required. Ask your parents if they know of a singer called Phil Collins, and they might understand where that title comes from. So, my chemistry education, it might seem odd to you now, but at some point in your future, you may be asked about your school days, and you quite often hear about it when famous people get interviewed. About inspiring teachers, and I'm sure you're all fairly ambivalent to your teachers at the moment, but looking back, I can honestly say I had a superb teacher in my third year, as it was called then, I think that's now year nine, who was my chemistry teacher, and he brought chemistry to life. Whenever people say science can be boring, I say, well, science, or chemistry particularly, is all about bangs and flashes and smells, and this teacher made it the bangiest, flashiest, smelliest lessons, which I found absolutely brilliant. So after studying GCSE and then A-level, I then went on and studied chemistry at university. I went to the University of Southampton, and I studied what ultimately became called was a Master of Chemistry, but when I first applied for it, it was called Chemistry with Professional Training. And what this course involved was a standard three-year chemistry course where you do the core disciplines around organic, inorganic and physical chemistry, but I also did some subsidiary subjects around maths, biochemistry and pharmacology. But what the course did, and it was quite different at the time, was I think now MChem has become pretty much the standard, is it gave 6 months in industry. Now the idea of a sandwich course has been around for some time, but what the fourth year, so after 3 years I did a fourth year, which I went 6 months into industry with Zeneca. Zeneca Specialty, which I don't think exists anymore. Zeneca was a part of ICI, which was spun off in the early 90s. And I worked for the specialty chemicals in dye formulations. And what that did for me, it gave me some real world research experience. So working on unknown projects, unknown challenges, projects that related through to having a commercial application. And it wasn't just research for research's sake. You know, these were problems that needed resolving so the company could carry on and make more money. What it gave was partly that real world experience. You got some good references as well. So my lab supervisor and other people in the company would be willing to give me good references later on in life or when I started applying for real jobs. But the other good thing about it was you got paid after 3 years of being a poor student. You did get a few quid in your bank account at the end of each money, which made the whole process much more rewarding as well. So after six enjoyable months with Zeneca, I then went back to Southampton, where I did 6 months of additional lectures, and some of them were with or either run by postgrads and PhD students. So you've got a good understanding of what some of the PhD students were working on as well. So again, it was all about extending your experience, extending your knowledge, and really seeing what happens once you've graduated in chemistry and where your life can go. Now, why did I choose the Master of Chemistry? Well, partly when I went to university, which was back in 1991, I could already see then that lots of people were going to university. So back in the 1950s, when the sort of time my parents would have been considering going to university, not that either of them did, only around 5% of the UK population went to university. In the 1980s, when my elder siblings were looking at going to university, only about 10 to 15% of the population went. In the 1990s, when I went, it was about 20%. And now that level is up to about 45%. So what's even more true now is that, you know, having a degree isn't or wasn't the differentiator that it used to be. And whilst chemistry is a superb degree to have, I thought that it would be good to have something that was a bit of a differentiator, something that gave me a little bit more world experience that would be easily transferable into the world of work post-graduation. However, after doing all of that and spending time in a lab and doing an extra year at university, I decided that I didn't want to spend my life in a lab coat. Working at a bench and running experiments wasn't, whilst I enjoy what I did, I didn't want to do it for the rest of my life. So what did I do? I went out and sold things. Going into sales is a really good way to get business experience. It gives you good rounded experience. You're dealing with people you've never met before. It gives you a whole host of experiences of organizing your time, meeting deadlines, organizing your diary, a whole host of things, you know, which in itself could probably form another talk in its own right around, you know, the joys of sales and the commercial world. Now, one thing I will say is, unfortunately, sales does sometimes have a bit of a negative connotation. People tend to default to the pushy telephone salesman or the double glazing people who won't leave your house at midnight. But you know, this is, when you're into the world of sales that I was in, it was very much consultative selling and selling products that people actually needed. Without the things that I was selling, people couldn't actually run their businesses. And the sort of things I went into was, first of all, was pharmaceuticals. Then I went into specialty chemicals, which was a very interesting one. So this was chemicals that went into things like engine oils, hydraulic oils, and also fuel additives as well. So this was with a big petrochemical division of Chevron Oil. And the fuel additives, these are the things when your parents go and fill up their cars with gasoline and diesel, then these are chemicals that are in the fuel to keep the engine clean. Performance enhancing additives that make sure that the engine keeps running as it should do. I then went and sold sugar, a commodity, which further enhanced my commercial expertise. Ate a lot of cakes during my sugar time because we had technology kitchens. And then I went back into the world of oil. I realized after setting outside of the chemicals and the oil world that I realized that oil was what I particularly enjoyed, but the sugar world, to get me into the world of biofuels. And this was going back in 2005 when biofuels were relatively new. They're very established now. And I got into working on biodiesel and bioethanol, which went into diesel and gasoline respectively. But over the last 12 plus years, that sort of pure commercial expertise has taken me into the world of trading, technical roles, so providing technical support to customers, the internal within the companies that I work for, operational world of moving product around, whether it be ship, pipe, truck, rail, and quality roles. And the quality role was also particularly interesting when it came to the biofuels world, because when you start adding biofuels into regular mineral fuel, you do have a whole host of quality roles, quality challenges, whether it's sort of quality of the product not being applicable anymore, or even bugs and microbiological contamination. And then next to a lot of those roles, you'll see a little asterisk there. And in all of those roles, having a technical degree, chemistry or something like chemical engineering, was absolutely crucial. So whereas, you know, doing research, a chemistry degree is probably an essential part, they were equally required in these commercial roles because you needed to understand the products, you needed to have an understanding of how they acted, how they behaved, so that you could communicate that to counterparties, customers, people you're buying from. And having that chemistry technical background was very, very important. I'm very lucky at the moment. I'm described as an oil industry professional. I work for a large petroleum company that happens to be British, and I'm in new business integration, a lot of it around new in renewable energy, biofuels as well. And that pulls on both my long-standing technical chemical understanding ability and my friend the expertise generated and gained during the Lowe's roles in my previous 20 plus years. So what is the value of chemistry? Well, where it gets to is, on a simple basis, it actually makes life a lot more interesting. So whilst I'm not actually getting my hands dirty in the laboratory, I can understand what is happening with the products that I'm working on and why they behave in certain ways. And some of the points I've just put up on the screen there are sort of considerations that maybe I've had to understand over the time and also explain them to other people as well. Things like, you know, how much of a component can I blend and not exceed a spec? An awful lot of the oil industry is governed by specifications. Products need to meet a certain standard. And if you want to blend additional points, components in, then you will be limited in having to understand why. And that can be anything from understanding, you know, a molar contribution of oxygen in a gasoline blend component, or even to what happens if you had more of this product? Will it put a parameter like sulfur off specification? What happens when you add bioethanol to gasoline? So ethanol is being added to gasoline. Ethanol is a renewable fuel. And when you add the two together, it does all sorts of strange things. And it's good to be able to understand that. When you're looking at biodiesel, two important feedstocks of biodiesel are tallow, which is animal fat, and palm oil. And these have very good cetane ignition properties, but they also form wax. And if you look at the molecules of these two particular products, you can understand why they do that. From my lubricant additive days, why does an engine wear? These all sorts of conversations were fantastic to me, because as well as being a chemist, I'm a total petrol head, and I could talk about engines all day if anybody was tolerant enough. Then you get into some of the other aspects of, you know, the organizational skills that chemistry brings to you. Things like, how do I develop an auditable sustainability system? So within the biofuels industry, you have to do a lot of reporting of information. And that information has to be audited by independent companies who will come in and say, yep, I agree that what you're reporting there is correct, or there's no reason why it isn't correct. And we'll sign that off. And that discipline, that scientific rigor is important in these in some of these processes there. So all of these processes, I don't doubt, could be done, or a number of them could be done by people who don't have a technical or a chemistry background. But certainly having that background just makes it a lot more interesting. It brings it a lot more to life. And in some ways, it makes it a lot more easier to explain. And it's that interest as well relates to sitting in a meeting. It's not uncommon for me to get up and draw some C's and H's, some carbons and hydrogens, to explain why things do and don't work. So that's a very sort of hands-on examples of where chemistry has been particularly useful to me, and would probably be useful to other people as well if they were to go into a similar sort of role. But what I also just want to highlight is the way that the writing of your chemistry, particularly your practicals, also have direct applications to the world of the commercial world. So going back many years, I was taught the best way to write a practical was an introduction. Why are you performing the experiment? A method. What did you do in that experiment? Your results. What you saw, what you monitored, what you recorded, and then the conclusion, pulling together your results and referring back to your original introduction, and also deciding what you can conclude or whether it disproves your original opening hypothesis. And whilst we can use that for our practical work, it's also a useful way I found when applied to business plans or when trying to justify requests in a company. So just comparing the two, So when it comes to, you know, a business plan, quite often in work, you'll have to, you know, justify some money being spent. You'll need to go to somebody and say, I want to invest this money. I want to take this step. I want to pursue this project. And most of the time, somebody will come to you and say, well, that sounds like a great idea, but is it going to work? Is it going to give us some return on investment? Are we going to make a profit out of it? So the way I've often structured the presentation of these ideas is an introduction. So in your practical, you're saying, why are we going to perform the experiment? Use that example in your business plan. What do you want to spend the money on? What do you want to do? Describe your idea. Method. In your practical, you're looking back and saying, what did you do? Or potentially you could say, what are you going to do? In the business plan, you can say, how am I going to take action here? How am I going to invest? What processes do I want to follow? And map out exactly how your resource, your time, your effort is going to be employed. Results. On your practical, what did you see? Business plan. On your results, you can look at it and say, what do I think is going to happen? What do I hope the results are going to be? What would I like to see in a particular period of time? And conclusion, well, in your practical, you refer back to your original purpose and notes. In your business plan, you can say, well, my conclusion is, if I get the funding and if I act in this way, this is how I think the results are going to be. I will grow business by this much. I will get this much more profit. I will solve this problem. And it's that sort of problem-solving route that I want to go through, because this style keeps you on track and keeps the description of what you want to do nice and clear. Because one thing you will find as you go through academic life and into your career, brevity is very, very important. People don't want waffle. Now, I know that's, you know, probably the stages a lot of you are at. You're having to write essays of a particular length, maybe on a subject you don't like. I remember the pain I used to go through trying to write an essay about World War I poetry and trying to drag out my arguments and my description. But as you get into certainly degree level chemistry, a lot of the requirement is around being to the point, being concise and clear. People don't want to have a lot of waffle. And in fact, I did a course by the Institute of Directors once on a finance course. And I was told there, if you can't get your business plan across in 4 pages, it's not worth it. You haven't got it identified clearly enough. My current company, if you haven't got it in 2 pages, the idea is not good enough, or you haven't been able to explain it properly. And the last point on that slide just takes you back to, I wonder why, it's not surprising, I don't feel, with some of the writing style you have to just develop as you go through your chemistry studies and your chemistry chemistry career. I actually work with quite a few chemists in commercial roles. Some of them are in finance roles, some of them are in business development roles. But I just feel that sort of structured approach to how you organize yourself does have considerably wider applications than just as a bench chemist. Well, as a bench chemist, don't want to belittle any of our bench chemists there. So the final things I just want to put out there as thoughts about studying chemistry. Chemistry at university is difficult. Maybe that was just me, maybe I wasn't very clever enough, but a hard subject. You have a lot of demands on your time. Another important thing it's just worth flagging up is A-level maths is required. Certainly was when I went to university. Now, I happened to study A-level maths, so it wasn't an issue for me. But if you do go to university, you really want to consider the maths element. Those colleagues or fellow students of mine at university who didn't have maths as an A-level subject did have to do some additional maths courses just to get their maths up to speed. You will have a lot of lectures, tutorials, and lab time if you go to study chemistry at university. By your third year, it is pretty much like running a full-time job. You'll get into the college site at 9 o'clock in the morning. You might have 2 or 3 lectures. You'll have some tutorials. And then certainly by my third year, I was doing sort of 2 till 5 Monday to Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, Friday in the lab. I had a few arts friends at universities, and they did spend an awful lot of time in the library coffee shop. I certainly didn't have that. But the projects that you end up working on, you know, they're challenging and uncertain. And this is when you get to your third year, you quite often do a third year project. It's one and two, pretty standard practicals, all well known. The results are pretty much predictable. But by the third year, you are going into new areas, things that people haven't looked at before. And it is unknown. You know, there are no right or wrong answers that when you're living with research results on a day-to-day basis. But the point I'll make is, if you do go to university and study chemistry, you will end up with a very valuable degree, a challenging degree, a well-respected one, and it's applicable to pure science world, but also wider commercial ones as well. I study chemistry, spent most of my life in a chemistry applications environment, never regretted it and thoroughly enjoyed it all the way through. And that's it. So I'm happy to answer any questions if anybody's interested.
Thank you, Robin. That was brilliant. Does anybody have any questions at all that they'd like to ask? You can come off of mute and ask them, or you can type them in the chat. If you don't have any questions, you're obviously free to leave the call. So did you ever consider an alternative career path when you were at school? Did you think, when I grow up, I want to be anything completely different to what you ended up doing?
I don't think so. I mean, you have all sorts of weird, wonderful ideas as you go through school. I think the sort of world that I'm in now, a lot of the jobs that are done there just didn't exist years ago. If you think about some of the projects I work on, a lot of it is around sort of sourcing feedstocks for biofuels. You know, when I was at school, biofuels, they were known. You know, Brazil's been running on bioethanol, high levels of bioethanol in their gasoline for nearly 50 years now. So I don't think I credibly thought of anything else I was planning to go into. You know, I suppose my biggest learning point was, you know, I realized I didn't want to be in a lab coat all my life, but I knew I was very lucky to find things that there's a big commercial world out there for chemicals, petrochemicals and oil. And with the challenges the world has around energy security, energy supply, I think there's phenomenal opportunity for those people who have a scientific or an engineering interest at the moment.
Answer. There's no questions in chat, so I think possibly you've actually covered everything.
Or I've said everybody's asleep.
Let's stop sharing the screen. I'm just going to find a link and pop it into chat for a feedback form. Okay, so if you do have any questions once we've ended the call, feel free to pop them on the feedback form and we can pass them on to Robin for you. There you go, I've popped the link into chat, so I'm going to stop recording.